Morning.
Morning.
Some of you guys, it's Sunday morning, right? And the weather is very fine, so it should be better, right? Okay, we'll not say good morning in a normal way. Typically, we always say good morning and a speaker will ask you to repeat, right? Good morning. So that's what I'm not going to do. I'll try to start with something different. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to say we will. And you are going to say something that you want to do. Somebody wants to be a success. So what should you say? We will succeed. Somebody wants to be a winner. So we will win. Okay? So we will
forward.
What does it look like? So we have to change this. So let's first try to repeat that we will win part. We will
win.
We will
win.
Yeah, that's better. So that sounds like a collective success, right? Now winning could mean anything. Do we agree? It could be in your career, it could be with your family, it could be with your job, it could be with your in sports, right? And it could be in a scientific mission, Tathagat is here, so I always remember that. But now, when I get start about the session, in fact, I have to rename Saket as Dr. Saket Bansal. You know why? Because Saket was talking about symptoms and problems and so on. So typically, who would start with that? Doctor, right? So we have a right to call him doctor. So henceforth, we should probably call him doctor. But now, once you know these symptoms, okay, what are your choices? Typically, a lot of us are home doctors. We are, right? So there's a symptom, or I have fever. What do? Pop a pill, Prozin. Okay, I'll take a mox or some antibiotic. So there are two ways you can actually, if you know the symptoms, if you have a problem, if you have a challenge, you can get it solved. Either you can be a self-doctor, which a lot of companies, a lot of clinicians try to do now. You can go to a pharmacist, right? I won't tell what are the pharmacists here. We're going to come back to that. Yes?
I was going through your slide. I found two things very interesting. Accidental agile coach. Why the word accident?
So that's a discussion for later, we'll come back to that. And in fact, because you raised it at the right time, so when you talk about coaching, it comes from two perspectives. So first, my entry into this world itself was by accident, okay? But most of the times, us coaches are actually called in when an accident happens. So agility happens by accident. Oh, somebody discovered agile is there, let's do something. Somebody discovered, I think, some challenges you were saying, right? Oh, this is not working for me, my team is waterfall, we need to do something. Again, some accident happens. So we are always asked to be the doctors and can you please give us a band-aid or something. So that's where the topic of this talk is today, talking about effective coaching. How many of you have coaches here? Okay, so we have about 5 or 6. How many of you are managers here? Good, wonderful. How many of you are team leads here? Good. How many of you are parents here? Wonderful. So, first notion that we need to dispel, oh, I am not a coach. If you are a parent, you have taken your first journey towards coaching. So you are already a coach. So coaching does not start by studying CSM or become a CSP or PMI, ACP and so on. Where does coaching start? Coaching starts with you. Right? So, if you are working with someone, trying to help them in any way, whether it is our parents, whether it is our kids, whether it is our colleagues, are you a coach yourself? Yes, you are. So, I see about 150 coaches here. And that's why the topic I wanted to talk about was effective coaching. Is this working? Yes. But, in a professional world, a lot of you have been working with coaches. You are coaches themselves, should have faced these questions. Oh, we will hire a coach. But is it going to be effective? These guys charge so much, right? I don't know why they charge. So what ROI am I going to get? You hear all those kind of questions that you see? Right? Can a coach really help us achieve organization goals? We also talk about that. So I'm going to answer or try to answer some of those questions today. But before that, I'm going to ask a few questions back. So, what's the difference between a consultant and a coach? Yes, please.
Coach
coach takes responsibility of helping you out to guide you in finding ways to solve the problem, to help you recognize, to help you give mechanisms by which you can identify your own problems, mm-hmm. and direction in which you can seek training and you'll get relevant trainings to solve your problems rather than solving them for you. And a consultant is about, my business is telling you what to be done, you pay my check, I'm done with you. I don't care if you're successful or not, but a coach takes more responsibility of the success of the team.
Okay, so I'm not sure whether it was heard. What our caller here has to say is, coach is who takes responsibility of your success. Okay, by making sure that he is working with you or she is working with you to make sure you succeed, finding out the right answers. Whereas a consultant is just there to give the advice and take the paycheck and go. Do we all agree? No? Yes, you had something to say.
Consultant gives you prescriptions. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, this worked there, so it should work here.
Okay.
And, this guy tells you what exactly to do. But coach might help you in finding out yourself without him knowing the things, that mm-hmm. this is what will be suitable for.
Okay. So aren't we again talking about a pharmacist here? So when you talk about a consultant, are we not talking about a pharmacist? Oh, you do this, take this pill, and you will be good. Whereas a coach goes a little deeper. So, this is where the problem also starts, because Dr. Saket was also talking about, and all of you are also talking about, how we perceive agility, correct? And everybody, the management wants something else, the managers want something else, and you want something else. Do we agree? So the perception of coaching itself might be very different. Perception of agility itself is very different. Do we agree? So why don't we take 30 seconds? I will not even go to coaching part of it yet. Let me take you two steps back. All of your notepads in front of you. So take 30 seconds and write down what is agility for you. So what does agile mean for you? Write down, what does agile mean for you? I said we don't write essays, 30 seconds, right? So don't write essays. In 30 seconds, definitely you cannot write essays. Okay. So Arshia, what have you put there?
Accountability and responsibility.
Okay, good. Parath, I can see you from here. Do you want to talk about something? Can we get the mic, please? That would be helpful.
It's like adding values and principles.
Okay, good. Harpreet? Harpreet?
Deliver business value.
Deliver business value. Okay, do we have something more here? Yes, please. Delivering business value faster responsibility. Yes, please.
Yeah. Changing our ways of working as the real-time feeds come in so that we hit the target as it keeps.
So changing the ways of working. Okay, good. Yes, please.
Minimize wastage of time and resources.
Being transparent.
Self-management.
Self-management. Okay, wonderful. Yes, at the back, please. You have to be a little loud.
To accept, welcome, and respond to change so as to deliver maximum business value.
Okay, good. So, now who's going to quickly tell me the principles or the main part of the Agile philosophy? What do we call it? Manifesto, the holy book of agility, right? So what are the four key principles? Quickly, I just want the first words, not the last words.
People.
Collaboration. Working software or something which we can see. Collaboration and
responding
to change. Okay, good. And then we have all the other practices and things which go along with it. But I'm thinking, and because Dr. Saket also mentioned, are we thinking just about processes and practices when we talk about agility, or do we go beyond? Somebody will be the discussion about values and philosophy and so on. So I always considered Agile as a philosophy. Okay. Now, I'll not go into details of the philosophy and why Agile is a philosophy, but because that's an offline discussion. But when we talk about a philosophy, it has a certain value and belief system. Do we agree? Okay. And as individuals, as people, do we also have value and belief system?
Yeah.
Yes? So, let's try to bring that up. Again, I'm going to give you not more than 2 to 3 minutes, obviously. We have shortage of time. So why don't we write down in 500 words, or if you can reach 500 words in 2 to 3 minutes, or at least one page about you. Now, I'm not going to look for, okay, this job I do, or I'm a project manager, I'm a coach, I'm an engineer, I'm not looking for that. What I'm looking for is, what is real you? So in 250 words, 200 words, whatever words you can write, write down as many words you can write about you. Your notepad's in front of you, go ahead. So in 200 words, 250 words, write down about you. Why I'm going to talk about this and why I'm talking about you is I'm going to just go to the next slide. Again, don't write about your job, about your experience, about, okay, I'm a manager, I'm a consultant, I'm a coach. Don't write about that. Write about you. So I hope everyone understands what I'm, where I'm trying to get here. Still thinking.
Primarily, this is again a philosophical question. I'm myself not able to identify who am I.
Good. I can expect the dilemma. I'm going to shortly talk about that why. And we are supposed to talk about effective coaching and why am I talking about you. So I'm also going to come back to that in a minute. A lot of you have already put down their pens, are still thinking. What happened? Pardon?
It's a very difficult job.
Very difficult job.
Right.
Why?
Very difficult.
Think of what we are. You have spent, all of us have spent at least good 25, 30 years on this Mother Earth, right? And you have all the experiences, all the things from the past that you should be able to talk about. So we talk about transformation, we talk about change, we talk about big words. But first of all, are we able to understand ourselves? What we stand for. If you probably, I'll give you more time and ask you to write about something. All of us are going to say a few words. I like to connect to people and I like to talk to people. How many of you would say that? Let's raise hands. I like to collaborate, I like to talk to people. A lot of us said that? Okay. How many of you actually like or you have more of a nature that you want to make sure everything is finished and as per the everything is looking good, it is perfect, and it is absolutely as we had wanted. How many of you are from that perspective or look for that perspective? Oh, quite a few hands here. I want to be make sure, and I think our my colleagues on the other side, they're always there, right? Homemakers and mothers and so on. We have to make sure everything is good and set and complete. Okay. How many of you like networking, talking to people, and making sure we collaborate with each other? Good. How many of you planned a holiday in last 5 years which could not go through and you had to change your plans? How many of you change your path to office every day because of traffic jam, rains? Happens all the time. But if you realized, I was also not talking about what you guys do. I was talking about Agile Manifesto. People, collaboration, responding to change, okay, and working product. So agility and coaching agility or managing a team in terms of agility does not start from learning about Scrum, learning about XP, learning about that, learning about any other methodology. Where does it start from? You. Okay. And when you want to be an effective manager, effective leader, effective coach, effective even a parent, what should you look for first? What's my value and belief system? Okay. Does it match with what I am going to talk to my team about? A lot of us think, okay, my business is different, my work is different, and my personal life is different. Are we really able to differentiate between those two? Very difficult, right? Because we think in a certain way. We have certain values and belief systems which we cannot take away. So don't think about agility as a process, as a set of practices. It is about what are my values and belief systems and what are the other person's values and belief systems, and can we create a synergy between these. Okay. So come there. So as I said, your first step to coaching, your first step to transformation is we. Are we connected together? Do we share certain values and belief systems which are going to help us be together? And then from we move to them. Who is them? We is obviously you too, right? It's a singular part. Who is them? And what do we call them? Team. My team, right? My project team, my work team, my family. They are them. So that means we need to find those common values, belief systems also into that ecosystem. And then we talk about those. Who are those? Stakeholders, sponsors, executive management, who are separated by a certain degree of separation, by hierarchy, by time, by geography, and so on and so forth. So when you talk about a transformation, when you talk about running a successful transformation, you have to focus on all these three. So where do you start your change and your coaching from? From self. Okay, and then take it forward. So first, you need to define the space for coaching. What are we really talking about? What are we really transforming? Are we just focusing on superficial changes? Oh. And I think Dr. Saket was also talking about it. Are we just talking about a process change, which is yet another process change? There was CMI, there was ITIL, there was all the PM work related practices, and now we are talking about Scrum. Are we just focused on that? Because a lot of symptoms that you guys mentioned were precisely that. Oh, my boss does not, my product owner does not come to my meetings. Okay, my management does not understand, or we are studying Scrum because we are distributed. You face all those parts? Now these are all practices. These are all when we talk about the superficial coaching. Okay, so are we talking about just surface coaching, surface transformation, or are we talking about deeper behavior changes? I think somebody, you talked about that part also. So think, when you are as a manager, as a leader, what do I really stand for? Am I still focused on the processes and the practices, or I'm able to think beyond? So that means you need to focus on the mindset first. Do we all agree? And mindset change, does it happen in a day? Can you boil ocean in a day? So I'm always asked by a couple of CEOs that I always approach, oh, can you make my team agile in 3 months? Okay, or how much time will it take to make my team agile? I said, I don't know. Who will know?
Team
and you. How can I tell as an external entity how much time you take to transform? It all depends on you. So it's all about thinking about the mindset, planning the change of mindset, talking about the actions and getting the feedback. But this sounds familiar. Isn't this the typical agile iterative cycle we talk about? Right? Plan, do, check, act. PDCA cycle. So when we try to talk about agility and transformation, are we trying to talk about and are we constantly reinventing, rethinking and retrospecting what is happening? Or we just go the other way around? So let me ask for some experiences here again. So, how many of you have started your Agile transformations, Agile journey in last 3 to 6 months? Okay, last 1 year. In your organization, in your team, how many of you have started thinking about Agile, Scrum in last 3 months to 1 year? I don't see many hands. Okay, few hands. Last 2 years? Okay, last 2 weeks? No, last 2 weeks. Good. And typically, where does the spark come from? Where did it all start? Who started this moment? Talking about transformation, who started this?
Hi, good morning. I am delivery manager and I have large team. So how it started? Because in 2013 I started a large project, and we had a plan to deliver whole modules by end of December. But in December it was total failure. Actually, nothing was ready, and we needed 6 more months to complete everything.
Okay.
So there I started thinking, let's plan Agile delivery.
Let's plan Agile delivery.
Okay. So that my modules are delivered month by month and we can have better.
Good. Delivery. So in how many organizations, and all of your relative different organizations, the managers started the wave? Okay, I am the manager, I said okay, or somebody else at my peer said, let's talk about Agile or Scrum. Okay, raise your hands. Don't be shy, I know nothing goes out of this room, don't worry. In how many organizations it was coming down from the management? Oh, we have to be agile because my customer says so. We have a way to go. I heard about something in a conference. Okay. In how many organizations a team member came to you and said, guys, agile looks wonderful. Let's get started. One. Interesting. And what was the very first part of the Agile manifesto? People. So have your people really bought into this transformation? Or because you said so as a manager, you said so as a leader, they are doing another process? Where is it coming from? So when you talk about these transformations, who should be a party to it? Team? Who should be the decision maker? Team. Do we really allow them to make decisions? In terms of transformation and processes?
Yes, we should.
Yes.
We should, but do we do?
Yes, we do.
No, I see a lot of no's also. I see a couple of yeses, yes.
They are part of it, but they
are
not.
They are part of it, but they are not part of it. It's almost like when we were still teenagers and one of our brothers and sisters got married. Were we a part of it? Yes, we were a part of it. But then who took the decisions? Somebody else. So how much we are connected to this? We had all the fun, we danced our life and everything else. But did we really own that thing? No. The moment I got a chance, I'll run away to play or do something else. Happened? And then we complained, my team members don't listen. They don't follow the process. They don't follow the transformation. If they have not bought into it, where will they talk about it? Why should they talk about it? So as a coach, as a manager, as a leader, what should be your first part, a first thinking part?
Enrollment.
Yes, so agility cannot be mandated, driven down. It always has to be opted in. What's the difference between managed, pushed down and opted in? More acceptability, okay.
You feel strongly with the cause, you are convinced that this is value, then only get engaged. Otherwise, it's like wind sports, then you would find ways just to make you happy, otherwise I'll, you know,
okay.
Under covers I'll do something else.
Yes, so let's talk about sports people. And in sports, we have coaches, right? And we have teams. And they are also very agile by definition. So our sports, our games, an opt-in mechanism or a mandatory mechanism? Oh, you have to play this. You have to be in the national team. You have to be in the state team. Do we always push that?
No.
So what is the flow always?
Opt-in.
And then I want to excel. I want to make sure that I am the best in this field. I am giving my maximum. So till the time your team members have opted into this process, into this change, will they be giving their maximum to make sure that we work effectively and successfully?
No.
So that's where the coach, the manager has to focus not just on giving advice, telling people what to do, but be a moderator. All of you in chemistry and physics in your schools read about the nuclear reaction. So adopting agility is more like a nuclear reaction. And your coach, manager, leader has to be a rod which is inserted. Okay, now let's start the chain reaction. Yes, please. Can we have the mic with the gentleman, please?
Yeah, it's like a change management, what you are trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
So opting and like enrolling and all that, yes, you will find, like yesterday there was a wonderful video where one person started dancing and then great second person came after a lot of time, then after a lot of time, some other people came, then the old people came into. So in this journey, sometimes if you want the journey to be faster, probably and in 20% of the cases, you need to mandate certain things actually. You cannot enroll 100%, all I can tell you is that.
Mm-hmm.
Probably you can enroll to the extent of 60%, 70%, 80%, or else your journey is going to be longer.
Okay, so let me have a question back.
Yeah.
And I'm going to give that marriage example again. See, because we are Indians, we love marriages, right? So we don't need videos to make us dance. The moment you play a band in a marriage, so one person will come, then two will come, then three will come, and so on. Happens all the time. So we are Indians by heart, by all means. Somehow, similar happens when we talk about agility. Okay. If you try to mandate that, let me complete. If you try to mandate something, oh, you have to be in. What will I do? Same dancing example I'm taking. A lot of you are pushed into dancing, right? Your neighbor or your colleague or cousin or niece will pull you in. Then what will you do? Dance for a minute. And then, thank you very much, I run away into a corner. Right? But if you are really seeing that everybody is dancing, why should I be left out? Will you finally say, yes, let me try to get in also?
You not find it comfortable sitting outside.
Absolutely, because if everybody is on the floor, let me also join in. Why should I be the odd one out? So 80% of your people are definitely going to be obtaining if they see more flexibility that agility brings in, the more thought process that it brings in. Rest 20%, even if you bring them in, are they going to slow down that process more? Because rather than making this 80% more effective, we are focused on how do I pull this 20% guy's friend. Happens all the time. Most men struggle with that. So start that tribe which works with you.
So
okay.
more about buying in and accepting in rather than imposing.
Exactly. Okay. Because we talked about a chain reaction, now once you have started that chain reaction, you don't need to do the efforts. Who will do the efforts then? People who have already been bought in. Let them take those guys along, and that will happen eventually. Yes, please.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to say actually. Like the 20%, you'll find in the marriage, that party and all that dancing, you'll find 20% people, you pull them and they will again go back.
Yes.
You pull them, they will again go back.
Yes.
That is going to happen.
Yes,
and
that will happen.
Some people will not change so easily actually. Right. Like the mentality is 100% of the people are going to convert with same mentality is almost an impossible thing.
Absolutely.
So you'll find that 20%, that's what I was saying, that 20% figure you have also said. The 20% figure will have to bring them on board through some mandate. And 80%,
I think they will come, mandate may not be required. If 80% is bought in, the 20% will already come in peer pressure. And
yes, there's one more thing which I want to talk about here and why people run away from this. Let's say we talk about our sponsors, we talk about our executive management. So I'm going to change the context a little. Now for them, what matters at the end of the day?
Outcome.
Probably. dollars, earnings, profitability. So ultimately, at the end of the day, they are looking for some kind of data. Do we agree? Let's talk about our techies, hardcore engineers. What are they looking for at the every day? Do they care about data? Who cares? What are they really passionate about?
Technical learning.
Technology? Yeah, technology. Trainings? Learning. Tools? Give them all the latest gadgets and tools and trainings and they are pretty happy. Then you can tell them whatever you want to do. Okay, it is done. Then come the poor guys. Poor sandwich guys. Yes, you got it right. The sandwich managers. Now, every manager, before she goes to bed every night, what does she pray? Exactly. Hope no escalations tonight. I want to have a peaceful night's sleep. Happens all the time. So what are these guys really looking for? A good process which can tell them, yes, this will work fine, this is the role, this guy will take out the business for the business continuity planning, something fails, this will happen. So at the end of the day, they are looking for just the right process. Now, as a leader, as a coach, as a change agent, if you are able to provide all or showcase all these values to the right people, does the mindset change start happening? But more than that, okay, I'm fine, you do well, I think you are doing right, just go ahead. Happens all the time, right? So you have to create the right value. In fact, in my world, I call it the value-driven behavior management. Think about the value you are providing to each person in the chain and then bring them in. But no, what do we think when we talk about Scrum? How do we start? When you think about Scrum, you give me more business. Let's make everybody a CSM and we are good. Okay, let's train everybody on agile methods and we'll be agile. Will not happen. Unless you have created that awareness and desire, even if you impart knowledge, it will still remain bookish, it will still remain in a theory. Do we agree? So as a coach, your first part is to create that awareness and desire. Why we are doing it, why change? What are we going to look at maybe 6 months down the line if we adopt? So how many of us actually did that exercise in your company, your team? Why? I can see 7 or 8 hands actually in this whole room. Because Scrum came in, oh, we have to do Scrum. Scrum is the latest fad in the market. I will get my certification and I'll be done. No. And once you start this, you start moving away just from transactional coaching, transactional changes, to transformational changes. So what do you mean by transactional changes? Transactional changes, transactional coaching brings out just the surface issues. Okay? Example you want to know? So here is an example. The team should use story points. Why? Because Scrum says so. So what will the Scrum Master, the manager say? Because my trainer said you have to use story points, so the whole team would use story points. And then in the retrospective, there is a checklist, there is a check. Oh, we started using story points. Happens all the time. But the team does not understand the meaning of story points. In fact, I want to give a very interesting example. So we were coaching with a team and we were called in. So this team has been, it was in Gurgaon, not very far away. So the management of this team, they called us, oh, we have been using Scrum for 5 years. And now we want to go to the next level of agility. So can you please come and help us? I said, okay. So can you participate in some meeting? Yes, yes. So Monday morning, we have a sprint planning meeting. Why don't you come in? I said, okay. So the meeting starts, the Scrum Master comes in, the team member comes in. And then the Scrum Master says, okay, give me your story points. They're like, what's happening here? So one team member says, okay, I've got 6 story points. Another says, I've got 5 story points. The third person says, I've got 7 story points. And now I'm mightily confused, what's happening here? We have not even started the meeting, and these guys are already talking about story points. So finally they summed it up, and they said, okay, as a team, we have 45 story points. Now let's start estimation. So I was more curious, okay, what is the story point business about? Oh, no, because Scrum says, right, 1 story point is equal to 8 hours. So now we don't talk about hours. So we just talk about story points. So we have now 45 story points as a team. So is this the way you want to use story points? No. So transactional coaching will focus just on these issues. Okay. Oh, this is not the right way to use story points and use story points. Will not work. You need to go a little deeper, talk about behavioral insights, talk about learning from experiences, sharing information, and then taking it forward. Now to do that, what you need to do is you need to dwell on certain patterns. You need to dwell on certain behaviors from the past. There are certain insights that you need to capture. So a transformational coach, a transformation leader is going to focus on the insights and what you learn from experiences. So I'm going to talk to you about four insights here. First one is your reflective insight. What do you mean by reflective insight? You do it every 2 weeks. Retrospective. Going into the past and thinking about, okay, what did we do? Can we improve from there? Now this is not just about a team. Even if you are talking to an individual, a developer, a manager, a leader, there also you can get reflective insights. What are those reflective insights here then? How did you behave in a certain situation? When somebody pushed you, somebody pushed you to the wall, then what did you do? Oh, I behaved in a certain way. When somebody tried to pull you down and you were not promoted, how did you behave? So you learn from reflective insights, you learn from insights into the past, both as a team, also as an individual. So when you are talking to a person, a leader, then you focus on their personal past. When you talk to a team, how they have been behaving, working in a past world, in the past trips. The second one you talk about is the emotional insights. Typically, if I start abusing you out of a sudden, how will you behave? In fact, that happened with I was flying back from Bangalore late last evening. So it was about midnight, everybody is crazy at midnight. It's a red eye flight. So suddenly, at the end of the plane, we hear a commotion. Somebody was accusing each other of trying to disturb them and so on and so forth. So now these two people have started shouting at each other. But does it affect only them? The whole plane is looking back what's happening. Does it attract that attention? It does. In our teams, we have a lot of conflicts. Happens all the time. Now, does that create problems for the whole team? Most of the time it does. The team environment, the team part, it goes for a toss. So sometimes you need to learn from those emotional insights also. Oh, because this guy was told such a sale, he was not happy about it. That's why he reacted. This guy is looking very sad. I don't know what happened, so let me talk to him or her. It is not just about processes. You need to observe how people are behaving in a daily stand-up, in a sprint planning meeting, in a day-to-day life when they're actually coding. What will that give you? If you had a good fight with your spouse at 7:30 a.m. in the morning, for whatever reasons, and you go to office, how will your day be? Wonderful? Oh, I am free from home now. So how will your day be? Yes, so you pass it on to others. And a lot of us do not realize. In fact, it happens at the end of the day also. And now let's be honest about those confessions. A lot of us carry our work tensions back home. And you have a kid which is like 5-6 years old. So she comes to you and she wants to play, right? The moment mom and dad come from office. And then, what do? Stay away. I've just come from office, let me relax. Happens all the time. So was that poor girls or poor boys fall there? No. We get enslaved by our emotions. As a manager, if I have to think unbiased, sometimes I don't think unbiased. Oh, because this guy said something in that meeting, so I'm biased towards that. If you want a good team to be built, what do you need? You need trust to be built. You need your emotions to be under control. And you should know, okay, today I'm angry, so don't talk to me. Today I'm grumpy, so don't expect answers. You should be able to at least warn your people around you. This is what is happening with me. The rest two part, I'll probably push it through because we are short of time. even your intuition plays a part. Does it? How many times you had a gut feel that this will happen or that has happened? Any incidents or accident or work or somebody got promoted and so on? Raise your hands. So it is not just for one person, oh, this guy has a very good gut feel. And for everybody it works, right? So sometimes our, and where does the gut feel come from? Intuition come from? We say it comes from heart, but that's a wrong notion. Where does that intuition come from? So we have something called a subconscious mind, which is constantly working 24/7. It is a big database, right? Which is always analyzing situations, which is always trying to look into what is happening in the world, what do I need to be, and then it gives you those intuitions. So sometimes it may be a good idea to think about those intuitions and follow those. And last but not the least, and that's why when I talk about this slide, I always look up to Tathagata. And I always try to emulate him and say, maybe one day I want to go to Antarctica. Someday. So sometimes others play inspiration for you, and they are always an inspiration for you. So your insights also come from their experiences on how it has been done. But insights are not enough. Actions are also important. Do we agree? So because when you do each action, it deepens your insight, it deepens your learning. When your learning is deepened, you focus on building correct actions. Once you do that, your actions and insight get you to success or what you want to be. And that's why it always comes in phases. Do you want to see that, because I think one of our co-learners was talking about, oh, we want the change to be very fast. Yes, process change you can do tomorrow morning, everybody will be in. But when we talk about a transformation, that means it's a big change. Do we agree?
Yes.
And that has to come in phases. That has to come by asking the right questions. I think there was also something which Dr. Saket mentioned earlier. Are we providing a solution or are we asking the right questions? Because everybody's insights are different, their past is different, their experiences, their value and belief system, those are all different. Do we agree? So that means the best answers will not come from you, from your knowledge. Where will they come from? Their own experience, past and knowledge. So let the team members understand and come up with answers rather than providing an answer all the time. Okay? Because each level of insight, each team member supports each other in getting more insights and more fruitful actions. And this is where now the coaching pyramid pulls in. If you are a coach, if you are a leader, if you are a manager, where do you start from? In fact, there's one step which I forgot, which I actually should have added. How did we start this session today? Discovering about you, which is the first difficult part. So sometimes we are ourselves, the team members are unaware, what is the current reality? What do I really stand for? Correct? And then, so this is where, what is the coach happening here? What is the coach helping the team member in? They are trying to bring them to reality. Mr. Coachee, this is what is happening in the world. So let me show you the mirror. So I am now carrying a 20 feet by 20 feet mirror showing you where the problems are. This is what we started when Saket started. Then the role of a coach gradually changes. As the habit of your coaches, your team members start changing, he moves more from an investigator to a collaborator. So this change needs to happen gradually. Okay, but now another important aspect of coaching is to move your coachee, move your team members from negativity to positivity. But my question, or this question, is something that I don't have an answer to. So in your teams, with a person, particular person that you want to work with, whether he is your leader, manager, director, team member, do you see that negativity somewhere? I see some notes in the front. What about at the back? Do you see the negativity? So why don't you write down two things on your notepads? that you want to change or you would do to change this negativity to positive? Write down those two things. Now that you've learned about emotional insights, you've learned about, we are talking about how the coaching should flow. So write down those two things. Think about a person or your team and you see there's a negativity around that. How do you make it a more positive environment? What steps would you take as a team member, as a manager, as a leader to change this? So, anyone would like to share quickly? Yes, please, go ahead.
First of all, we have to always be positive.
Yes, you have to be always be positive. And?
Second thing, you know, we have to correct in silo and praise in public, basically.
Wonderful. Okay, more things?
Trust and open communication with myself, question is over
you. Okay, so think like them, put themselves in your shoes, okay? So enable trust and open communication. Good.
Respecting the situation is important.
Okay. Yes, please.
So stop the blame games in the teams and mm-hmm. bring a collaborative culture where people think they are working with their co-workers and not the competitors.
Okay. Good.
Share
in fact, that brings me to an exercise to close this session, which I'm going to talk about. Okay.
Share the
credit. Share the
credit.
Share the credits. Yes. Yes, please. Yes. Yes.
Basically, understand the real problem with them. At times, we overlook the underlying problem with them.
Absolutely. So dig below the surface.
Yeah. Understand the problem and empathize with them. Then coming out with direct solutions. Empathize, understand the problem, and then maybe at some point in time suggest.
Okay. Good. Good. Yes. Last one.
Yeah. I think something you were saying that elicit the solution from them. Elicit the solution from the other person only, trying to ask some leading questions.
Right.
So that he himself tried to give a solution to the problem.
Yes, because they are the experts, yes, you are not.
Yeah,
they know the situation
great point
problem
actually.
Better, so don't be the expert.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Okay, good. Yes. Now, I want to come back to that game that she mentioned and draw us into, but before I end the session, before I talk about that, I want to quote Thomas Merton. And this is something every day. Is it visible at the back somehow? So how many face this violence every day for yourself? Please raise your hands, be honest. I commit to multiple things. I do. Try to find peace with yourself. Once you are peace at yourself, all these conflicts, problems, challenges we talked about, they simply become secondary. What becomes primary?
Yourself.
How do I succeed? How do my team succeed? So that we all win together. That's what we started with, right? We will?
Win.
I don't hear it. We will?
Win.
We will?
Win.
Yes, that's the mantra should be, that we all of us win together. But before I go to the exercise and last part, in fact, there was a question which was asked yesterday and probably in these regional scrum gathering, why there are not many CSCs in India? Did somebody hear about that question yesterday? Yes, we had only 3 CSCs in India, right? So now, because I have about 150 coaches here, I want to invite all of you to participate in this little mission that I've taken. Mission 5017. 50 certified Scrum coaches in India by 2017. You don't need to be a super coach and experienced and so on. If you have the right vision, right mindset, you can be there. And who is going to do it and who is going to help you there? all of us together. So if you want to be with me in part of that mission of being a wonderful coach, being a certified Scrum coach, do come together. Okay? So with this, let's do a little exercise before we close, because I know Piali and Saket are going to push me out of this room now, that he is waiting. Can you do a little exercise? Get up from your seats, it's early morning. Let's get some work done. Okay. Now, I'm going to take you back to your childhood days. Right? And some of you, because you said your parents and so on, so sometimes your kids would have bugged you to play this game. First of all, before we get into that little discussion on what needs to be done, why don't you quickly find a pair partner in this room who is not on the same table as you? Who is not on the same table as you? Find a pair partner. Find a pair partner quickly. Have you found one? Good. Now you need to face each other. Face each other. Face each other. Yes. Now this game is called as stone, paper, scissors. But you are thinking something very complex? No. We can learn a lot from our kids. So this is something that I want to learn. So who does not understand stone, paper, scissors? Okay. So stone, paper, scissors is a very simple game. Every person needs to make three gestures. If you make this gesture, what does it represent?
Stone.
If you make this? Scissor. And if you make this? It's a paper. So what you're going to do is, each pair is going to play this game. So on a count of 1, 2, 3, both partners are going to show their symbol, whatever they think. So if there's a battle between a stone and a scissor, who will win?
Stone.
Because stone can break the scissor. What about scissor and paper?
Scissor,
right? What about stone and paper?
Paper.
Because paper can wrap around this stone. Okay? So that means from every pair you will have a winner? Right? First of all, you guys know names of each other?
Yes.
You make sure you know names of each other. Okay. Then the exercise does not end there. What are you going to do after that? So once there is a winner, that winner needs to compete with winner from another pair in the next round. Okay? But the little twist that I want to bring here is, once you lose and there is a winner there, the losers are going to cheer for the winner. Take your name and say, let me talk about Tathagat. Let's say Tathagat wins now. I'm going to shout, Tathagat, Tathagat, right? You get the idea? Okay? So every time from every round, whosoever are the losers, or after two rounds, you'll have three losers and one winner. So all those three cheer for the winner. And this way the competition continues in this room till the time we have
one
single winner. But remember, you have to cheer for your winners. Do make sure that if you lose, you just go to side and stand. What are you going to do? Cheer for your winners. Okay? Are we ready? And you don't need to wait for next round.
So what, just one single round?
Yes, so once that round is over, you find another winner and start playing with them. You don't need to wait for instructions. Self-managed team. Go ahead. Ready? Get set. Start. Yes, yes, let's have a demo. Let's have a demo. Somebody was not sure. Okay, let me play with Pankaj. Okay, I'm going to give you a little demo. So, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so who wins? Yes, I win. So then I can play with somebody else. Simple part. Just one hand. Then go for the another round. Repeat the process. Okay? Are we ready? Go ahead. Go ahead. And keep on cheering your winners.
Like you will do 1, 2, 3.
Yes, yes. Go ahead. Go ahead. Yes, who is the winner? Keep on cheering for your winners. Yes, yes. That's the way. Yes, shout the loudest. Shout the loudest.
Single go.
Shout the loudest.
Say three. Go ahead.
First go. Okay.
One, two, three.
Thank you.
One more.
Oh my goodness!
Thank you.
Was there just one winner?
No.
Everybody was a winner.
Yes. Yeah.
So let's shout it again. We will
win!
We will
win!
We will
win!
Thank you very much.
Thank you.